Welcome to part two of the Spirit Bowl special. I was going to do a halftime show, and I spent all day trying to figure out how to do it. And the truth is, I didn't do it because I'm having problems with doing graphics and artwork and stuff. I'm finding it superficial. I'm looking at it and say, wait a minute, there's no value there. Where's the value in this? A picture? Where's the value, really? And it's all drying up. It's amazing. But that's what happened. I was going to do a razzle-dazzle and me throwing all these, you know, all this wonderful stuff, maybe some music and song and dance, and make it all spiritually relevant. And then I said, you know what? It's not really spiritually relevant. I can't really make it spiritually relevant. It's superficial. It's style. It's styling. Too much styling is not enough substance there. There really isn't. We can get into more substance just in a couple minutes talking here than all the pictures can ever get into. It's just not enough. So, just came up empty on that, and just as well. Those things are drying up. They're drying up. They're not. But I can't get satisfaction from art and style and all that stuff anymore. I just say no. No value there. No value there. No value there. Continuity problem's the only problem I have. Other stuff's no value there. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. This is more and more and more. Just this is becoming the overall realization, sort of just an organic type of feeling, a movement towards that. Just the vision of oneness is the only value there is. There is no other value. In all the universe, there's no other value. Actually, nothing in the universe has value except the vision of oneness. That's a fact. Put it that way. And it's as absolutely true. No thingness in the universe has any value at all. Except the vision of oneness is the only value we're ever going to find in the universe. Because it's only that reminds us of reality. Only that reminds us of reality. So what good does it do to look at a bunch of pictures and graphics and stuff? I just sit there. Every day I try to generate something really cool, and occasionally I do, but then after a couple minutes I just feel like, this is nothing. It's nothing. It's not worth showing anybody. It's not. So, that's what's happening. And it doesn't seem, I could put up videos of really cool things I've taken video of, and again, I just said, no, there's no substance there. It's just style. It's just artistic style. It's just eye candy. It's just no substance. It has no value. It doesn't have any value. It doesn't explain anything, really. It's just, kind of like eating, you know, dessert or candy bar or something. No real nutritional value to it. No spiritual value to it. Now the result of the first half, first part one, when I had this incredible breakthrough realization, now I feel the stress of it. I felt the effects, and I just felt super exhausted and super tired. And really, you know, just have to, almost like collapsing. It was such a heavy, heavy, heavy insight. That basically we're just cannon fodder. Those who come into this world to try to help are just cannon fodder. We're the mice for the cats to play with, actually. You know, that's a heavy, heavy, heavy realization. The cats say, "Hey, we're bored. You know, we can't generate a belief in half truths unless we have some truth mice here to play with, toy with." So they invite us here in this world, say, oh, we really need help. You know, all this world's saying, ah, we need help, we're so trapped, won't you please come help us, all this stuff. And I said, oh yeah, okay. And I responded thinking, okay, the world really wants help, really needs help. You get here and then you ultimately realize that all that stuff was just an act. And they really just wanted truth, to toy with truth so that they could then believe in half truth. Wasn't genuine, really. No, just cannon fodder. They say, how can we have a war unless we have an opposition that we can demolish? Something like that. But it's more like a half truth saying, we need a foil, you know, a foil to come down here so we can fence with the foil and come up with a half truth. You know, it's like a dialectic sort of. They say, how can we have a dialectic process where we have polarization, and so we can arrive at the dialectic of that, which is the third option, so to speak, from that. Who was it? The Hegelian dialectic, or somebody, some German philosopher, or something. That's kind of like what it is. See, we need the, you know, the opposition here to sharpen ourselves on. And we want to challenge ourselves with the opposition so we can, you know, get even stronger in opposition and more belief in half-truths. So getting called into this world was again, just a complete deception. Got duped. Because you can see the actual suffering and misery of the people of the world. But they're still gaming the whole thing. They don't really, because of the continuity issue, they're not really sincere. So the situation has to be looked at from the angle of a continuity problem. It's the only safe angle to look at it from. You have to become an expert in that, a master of that, totally clear about the continuity issue, how it's resolved, and then accept the resolution of it, the vision of oneness. Otherwise, you're going to be duped. And you'll be bewildered and confused and hurt. You say, hey, I thought I came here to help people and nobody's really interested. What's going on here? and it's kind of like they call you in here just to see you suffer and fail, which makes their belief that, oh, you see, I don't really need to go home because home is so futile. It's futile. They want to imagine if the fear of the continuity problem, nobody wants to wake up. So they're desperate. Say, how do we strengthen our not waking upness? We need to be challenged. So let's bring people into the world who try to awaken us so we can then defeat them and strengthen our resolve to not awaken. But they need someone to come in to try and awaken them so they can reject them and ignore them. It's like that. It's really like that. Just amazing. I've noticed that the world, people really are not interested in awakening. They're interested in failing to awaken. But how do you fail to awaken unless you try and you fail and you're challenged and you think, oh, maybe this somebody can awake me. Oh, no, they failed. No, they couldn't do it. And we think, okay, I'm even more, have better defenses now than I had before. And this is just a grotesque waste of time. Don't think that those who come into the world to try to help awaken, don't think that they're pleased with this at all. They're not laughing at all, that is for sure. I sure not. I'm not over that. And no conscience about it too. The comatic mindset is they'll do anything to remain in the coma. And with no apologies or conscience whatsoever, they'll throw you into a ditch on the side of the road and never think twice about it. They're so insistent on remaining deep in this coma out of fear of the continuity problem. So again, I believe any approach to helping anyone has to have front and center the continuity issue is the only problem that I have. Has to have it. Otherwise, the whole situation is going to have great problems with it, actually. front and center. The continuity problem is the only problem that there is, front and center. So what I've noticed in practicing this is I might start out and say, oh, I don't have a continuity problem. I say, catch myself. Whoa, wait. There's a way to get into it. Our mind, I find that the world turns our mind around in the wrong direction. And I have problems. I'm start out with, I don't have a continuity problem. I say, wait, that's completely backwards. How did I get backwards on that? So the way to start out is to say, I have a continuity problem. Make a positive statement. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. And then you start introducing, I don't have a shopping problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a fatigue problem, I have a continuity problem. So in order to get the practice starting, start out with a positive assertion and say, I have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem that I have. And keep asserting that until you begin to pick up problems that you can deny. Say, I don't have a progress problem. I have a continuity problem. And there are all sorts of then problems will occur to you that you can say, I don't have that. I have a continuity problem. But to get it started, it's easy. I think it's easier to say, I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem that I have. And I fully accept it. I fully accept it and embrace it. I have a continuity problem, period. And that's the only problem that I have. And so you can say that until various problems occur to you, which then you can deny and say, I don't have that. I don't have a budget problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I don't have any budget problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have a money problem. I only have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. That's it. I just have a continuity problem and no other problems. So it's like that. And then as your mind starts to think about other stuff, say, no value there. That's what I was doing with all the artwork, the halftime show. No value there. Everything I tried, I said, no value there. Because there's no value there, is there? Now, there's no value to that stuff. It doesn't clue you into truth at all. Not really. Kind of gives you a feeling, feel-good feeling, like, well, I'm kind of making some efforts here, but it's not enough. It doesn't really do the job. Practicing, I have a continuity problem. That does the job, actually. I have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an artistic problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a style problem. I don't have a style problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. That's it. But I have it. Which is a great thing, because the Holy Spirit has the solution for me. That's a fantastic thing. So the way is to deny all the problems that you have, deny every single one of them, except the continuity problem, and insist that you do have that problem. That's the great way, the great quick way. As your mind tries to raise up other stuff, just say, nay, there's no value there. No value there, no value there, no value there. Only the vision of oneness has value. How do you get there? By accepting that you have a continuity problem and denying all other problems. Then you'll see the value in the vision of oneness. You'll see it. It's actually cold here in California. It's now back to seasonal weather. It's not summer anymore. We actually have to put on jackets instead of t-shirts and sandals. Which we're all complaining about it for sure. Very much so. Like, wow, it is so cold here. This is crazy. Crazy weather. Wow. I was told we're going to have a water problem in California years ago. And is it possible we could? They're already, the governor decided to not supply water to the Central Valley, a lot of farmers, and there's going to be incredible problems in the Central Valley. Massive amount of acreage not being planted, there's no water for it. Municipalities are being told, like our municipality basically, we're not getting any water from the Central Water Project. and you have to rely on groundwater and wells and all the reservoirs and stuff. I mean, we could be headed for a catastrophe here in California, as a matter of fact. But we can say, I don't have a catastrophic problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a drought problem. I have a continuity problem. Deny every problem except the continuity problem. That is the secret. That is the way. That is the way. And it enabled me to see just how utterly superficial existence is, and how it plays us all for fools. How it's heartless. It's merciless. As Jesus pointed out in the Course in Miracles, the ego has no mercy, no compassion, no heart. It fakes all that stuff for sure, but actually it doesn't have any of that. It is simply trying to generate belief in half-truths as the new reality. And it just uses truth for that purpose. It's just a user. The ego is just a total user. That's it. And you get used. You feel like you've just been used here, which is not a good feeling at all. And the problem is, now I see that my whole life I'm just being used. I've just been used my whole life. And I don't know how to stop that. It becomes very obvious, like, wow, I'm just getting used, that's all. not a pleasant thing. How do you get out of that? Get out of that? I don't know. Haven't been able to yet. But it's becoming increasingly clear. And I believe, okay, I don't have a being used problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. Deny the ego. Okay? Say, I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. Exchange all the problems of the ego for the continuity problem. Just make the exchange. Simple exchange. Now, this sounds a lot like the teaching in A Course in Miracles. It is, but it's coming organically from my own clarity. It's not coming from any book. But I would say the advice that Jesus has is, you know, it's the right advice, for sure. He says, make the exchange. You have to exchange one belief system for another belief system. Very accurate from my perspective. And I'm not someone who just believes in something because somebody says it. Like the Buddha said, don't believe anything I tell you. You got to check it out for yourself. That's great advice. So I've been checking it out for myself to see, you know, just keep looking and see what you see. And this is what I'm seeing. I think we're all kind of doubting Thomas's. You just have to embrace that. Just embrace it. Say, okay, I'm not going to accept something just because some authority just tells me it. And even Jesus says you can't, because you have to make an informed choice. You have to see what your options are very clearly. So you have to see it for yourself. And the more you see it for yourself, the closer you get to making, you know, better decisions and making the ultimate choice for the vision of oneness. So, I don't have a decision problem, I have a continuity problem. And I don't have an ego problem, I have a continuity problem. And I don't have a projection problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a desire problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a whim problem, I have a continuity problem. Just relentlessly deny all problems except the continuity problem. Because ultimately we're trying to wake up into reality which has no problems at all. So we cannot be clinging to all these problems. Consolidate all problems and exchange them. Bring them all in a wheelbarrow and say, okay, I'm going to exchange all these problems for just this one problem, the continuity problem. But the resolution of that continuity problem sees everything as smoothed out sameness, oneness, which reminds us of reality. With the potential problematical situation everywhere, but not actual having any actual problems at all. And the practicing of this, I don't know how long I've been doing it, what a week or something, or directly, not a long time. Results are profound, actually, tremendous results. I can feel there's a shifting paradigm within my psyche for sure. And it's sort of like I'm getting the upper hand on the, it's losing its grasp. So that's what you want in a technique. You want a technique that actually gets actual traction instead of spinning your wheels. A lot of us have spun our wheels for a long time in the sand, getting nowhere. Got stuck in the sand once on a beach. We drove out in the evening time, out on the beach, and got stuck out in the low tide out in, and couldn't get anywhere. And it was late and dark. We had no phones, no way to contact anybody, and we were stuck. And then the tide came in and the waves came in. We were in this panel truck, getting smashed by waves all night, listening to Led Zeppelin on an 8-track. That was terrible. That was really completely shredded, you know, my nerves. It was just like, wow. But, you know, we was just spinning our wheels. Couldn't get out of it. Couldn't get out of it. And it was a stupid, whimsical constellation of things of getting, going down the wrong path that ended up there. Sometimes as we're young, we just want to have an adventure. We don't care what it is. Just, we want to have adventure. So, but it was not a good adventure, actually. Most of the adventures I had were not good adventures. Looking back, and that just really caused a great deal of anxiety and dispiritedness and all that kind of stuff. So it's better for your adventure to be one, a spiritual adventure, saying, I don't have an adventure problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a youth problem, I have a continuity problem. Spend your time insisting that you have a continuity problem. And I would say that's got to be the fastest path to enlightenment. I can't imagine a faster path. If you just insist that you have a continuity problem, that's the only problem I have. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. And then be specific about all other problems. Specifically name them. Say, and anything that arises in your mind, and you just do it and 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 do it, and you are shifting your paradigm like nobody's business. You won't be the same. Your mindset will not be the same going forward. I don't have a stress problem. I don't have any stress problem. I only have a continuity problem. Now, of course, the effects of all our problems linger on, are still lingering about us, but it's sort of like there's a different focus, a different direction, different mindset taking place, you see. And at some point, it's going to absolutely, it's like the sun is shining once again. And sure, the fog is still there, but you can feel the intense heat of the sun, and you know this fog is, it's going to vanish quite soon, actually, by doing this practice. It is really like turning up the heat on the sun. It's shining again. It's shining strongly again. It's like a pressure system of warm air coming in, and you know, it's pushing all the cold Lamig air out. The Lamig, the cold, harsh wind and air. It's getting rid of it. And it is, so, but it takes a little time. You know, it's not instantaneous. We wouldn't want it to be instantaneous. It would shock us anyway. So I have not experienced any really abruptness, not really any abruptness. This morning, I went through about an hour or so of insight and gradually finally worked, and then I did have this kind of a breakthrough of I said, oh my gosh, I've just been played for a fool. And coming into this world, it was all just a trick. God didn't send me here, no guru sent me here, nobody sent me here. I got tricked into coming here for sure. Which is a good thing to realize. So, but, you know, that was a little bit abrupt, but not so bad. No, not, I wouldn't call it abrupt. It sort of like a gradual dawning and I see. And then it kind of, you know, reverberates through the day a little bit, but I'm fine now. You know, I don't really feel any acute effects or anything, but I think I feel this fatigue and exhaustion from the effort to, you know, get to this, you know, mountaintop or, it's been a huge effort. So I really put in a massive effort and had this very great breakthrough today. And then I had a very, very busy day and doing all this taping prior to the, you know, the Superbowl. So I have this spirit bowl for alternative programming here. The stupor bowl for the Comitati. It's not the Illuminati, it's the Comitati. Planet Cred Coma. I'm from the planet Cred Coma, and I'm one of the Comitatis. The Comitatis of the planet Cred Coma. Everybody thinks it's really cool to be walking around in a coma. And I've got tattoos of comatomas cat tattoos. You know, look how many comatomas tattoos I have. I'm really a gangster of comatosity. Yeah. And so everybody's like styling it. Comatosity styling. And, coma styling. And everybody thinks this is cool. This is really cool. This is hip. Wow. It's fun. Yeah, we'll check back later and see how much fun they're having. So, we just have to, we don't have a comatose problem. We have a continuity problem. I don't have a coma. Make it specific. I don't have a comatosity problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a comatosity problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a coma problem. I have a continuity problem. Well, they're trying to wake up Schumacher now. So, we will see how that goes, although they say it might take a long, long time. that's not a great prognosis, but you never know. Never know. Kind of a symbolizing the future of the world, this whole thing. Collapse of civilization, long period of this world seeming to be in ruins, and then maybe gradually I've seen that the terraforming arrival of people from other planets here, coming out of the underground. Many people went underground during this time, and they came onto the surface at a certain time and began to terraform the planet and stuff. That's what I saw happening to this planet. Like a video, I saw a video of the future. So the Schumacher thing is interesting, has parallels to that. They might say he might be take a long, long time to come out of this coma. It might be very, very gradual, so don't hold your breath. Sort of a collective coma on Super Bowl Sunday. Stupor Bowl Sunday. A collective coma. Everybody gets together and says, okay, let's see how deep we can go. Let's see if we can deepen our coma today and protect ourselves from the terrible continuity problem. We're afraid we're going to lose. The ego's going to abandon us and we'll lose all problems. We'll lose the universe. We'll have nothing, no problems anywhere. What are we going to do? We're so scared. Let's make sure we got a lot of problems. Let's watch all these athletes, you know, try to, you know, annihilate each other. But since we know that God solved the continuity problem for us, and the Holy Spirit, in its imagination, will, as a blessing, will keep everything, the whole universe, intact in its imagination, we don't have an ego problem. We don't have a coma problem. We only have a continuity problem. We accept that. We accept it. It's all about accepting the continuity problem. How I learned to love the continuity problem. yeah. It's absolutely true. How I learned to love the continuity problem. I love the continuity problem. Absolutely. I love having the continuity problem, which, you know, it keeps me from abruptly awakening, right? But by accepting that as my only problem, it also frees me from all other problems. And again, the RX for the continuity problem is a vision of oneness. So I have no other problems, and I get to abide in this bliss. Wow, that's a pretty good deal. all from just accepting the continuity problem. It's the best deal going, really. It's the we have the Bliss-kini or something. What is that? The Bandini, the Bliss-dini, the Deal-dini. You got the Deal-dini. The continuity problem is the Deal-dini. You can buy it now online for how much? It's free. Actually, it's free. It's online. It's free. The Deal-dini. How come they sell everything they sell has to have the dini, the bandini? I don't know, the knife dini. This is the knife dini. Cat's showing up. Maybe it's going to start bothering me. I don't know. Got frosty this morning, California. How about that? Plants don't know what to do. Really, really, they don't. Say, wait a minute, I'm all blooming and stuff. What's with this frost? Springtime has started 2 months early here. All the various stuff that happens in springtime actually is already happening now. At the end of January, it's like a couple months early. So if we go back into winter and say, oh, everything's going to be really messed up here. Well, that's okay, because we don't have a climate problem, we have a continuity problem. I don't have a climate problem. I have a continuity problem, and only a continuity problem. So everybody in the world is like freaking out with all the problems we have in the world. You can turn that around entirely. Literally free yourself from it. Say, I don't have... And name all these problems. I don't have those. Deny them, and you know what? You'll end up stratification. Will automatically you'll be stratified into the higher realms. Ultimately, the death-free realm, where there aren't any such problems. You also have the vision of oneness, but there'll probably be a stratification happening as well. Absolutely. So, if you get confused, start off with, I have a continuity problem. As you try to do these practices, as you're shopping in stores, or when you go to Home Depot or something, and you're trying to, I forgot, what is that again? I don't have a continuity problem. Say, no, I have a continuity problem. And you can do it. Wherever I go, I'm trying this technique out, and I find that you get confused when you're around public. So you have to start out, say, I have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a shopping problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a money problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a choice problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a decision problem. I have a continuity problem. Don't have a decision problem. Absolutely don't have it. I don't have a decision problem. I have a continuity problem. I've already decided the continuity problem is the only problem that I have. You just keep reinforcing this in your mind. It's reinforcement. It does wonders in your mind. Keep reinforcing it. Be very strict and adamant about it. You're telling the mind this. You're not negotiating. There's no negotiation taking place. I don't have a negotiation problem. I have a continuity problem. So there's no discussion, there's no dialogue or anything. You're just telling the mind, I don't have a dialogue problem. I have a continuity problem. Whenever the mind tries to generate some problem, catch it and say, I don't have that problem. I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. Oh yeah, mind, oh, by the way, I don't have that problem. I have the continuity problem. Thank you very much. And you're just informing the mind, this is how it is now. This is how it is. You can even say, I don't have a mind problem, I have a continuity problem. Don't have an ego problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a situational problem, I have a continuity problem. And then you get tired of this practice, then watch your mind and thoughts arise, say, no value there. Stop them, no value there. And you can do that as you're doing whatever you're doing at work, shopping, eating, whatever. No value there to watch your mind. Oh, no value there, no value there. And the practice is right in front of you, because your mind will be thinking thoughts for sure. So you can, it's easy to practice that. You just be aware of what, that your mind is thinking thoughts, and then just say no value there and stop them. Super easy to practice that way. Maybe that's the easiest practice of all, because everybody's mind is generating all sorts of thoughts all the time, or at least is entertaining these thoughts. Yeah, it's cold out here. Not used to it. Not used to it at all. It's ridiculous saying it's cold here. It's frigid in the rest of the country. What's going on? The weather's just harsh. I don't have a harshness problem. I have a continuity problem. See, when you're back there in harsh conditions, all right, here's an example. You just say, hey, I don't have a cold problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a harshness problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a freezing problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a storm problem. I have a continuity problem. I do not have a storm problem. I have a continuity problem. And you just tell the mind, this is where you're at now. You say, mind, this is where I'm at. So I'm leaving all that, those problems, I'm leaving them. I don't have them anymore. And am I saying I don't have them, meaning I've left them. They're gone. But you have to prepare yourself with this. Say, I don't have a climate problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a weather problem. I have a continuity problem. I do not have a weather problem. I have a continuity problem. Very important. And most people in the country can relate to this and practice it, because they're getting, you know, very harsh conditions. And just say, I don't have a weather problem. I have a continuity problem. And everything is in the mind, imagination of the mind here. So you're telling the mind you're going to change the whole imaginated, what the whole dream, the whole structure of the dream. You're going to change the whole dream into a dream where with only the continuity problem, where the solution of God rests as a vision of oneness. That's what you're going to change your imagination to. So I don't have a climate problem. I have a continuity problem. This practice is right in front of you all the time. Whatever's bugging you, or even not bugging you. I don't have an exhaustion problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an exhaustion problem. I have a continuity problem. But of course, you're not stupid. This is practice, prepping yourself. You see, for the vision of oneness. But of course, you don't stand out. You don't stand out in the freezing, the super sub-zero temperatures, and freeze to death. Of course not. Because you say, I don't have a stupidity problem. I have a continuity problem. Standing out and freezing to death would be a stupidity problem, right? And you don't have that problem. See, I do not have a stupidity problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a famine problem. I have a continuity problem. You know, the cognoscenti of the planet believe that we're going headed towards crisis, and I'd say that is absolutely correct. And again, phosphates and, you know, oil, has fueled this modern society. Cheap energy sources have fueled modern society, and phosphates have fueled the growth of populations, feeding the world. But there's limited supply, and when we start running out, then what? Then what? So we can say we don't have a phosphate problem, we have a continuity problem. I don't have a phosphate problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an oil problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a fossil fuel problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an energy problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have any resource problem at all. I don't have any resource problem. I have a continuity problem, and that's the only problem I have. Now, if you get the whole world thinking this way, everyone would have... That's a fact. But as it is, there may not be that many who ascend, actually. There'll be an ascension, for sure. Stratification at some point. It's very likely. But I don't see it's going to be a vast, great, you know, a lot of people. Because you have to be willing to leave your problems behind you and exchange them for the continuity problem, which has the resolution that God gave to it, right with it. It comes prepackaged with the resolution. You see, it's a prepackaged deal. You get the resolution with it. I don't want to freeze out here. But let's see if I can keep going. I don't have a freezing problem, but I also don't have a stupidity problem. I don't have a stupidity problem. I have a continuity problem. A lot of vapor. So, this is the Spirit Bowl and alternative programming to the Superbowl. For the comatades to get their comatose fix. So they can rest assured, rest comfortably, that they're sleeping very deeply in a deep, 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 deep coma. No danger of awakening, suddenly awakening. Again, the danger of suddenly awakening to fear is what holds everybody into a coma. So you have to approach this head on, honestly, and say, yeah, I do have a severe fear of waking abruptly. It's called the continuity problem. That's what we mean. A severe fear of an abrupt, sudden awakening, where all problems vanish forever. Forever. That's the key. Forever. We do have a severe fear of that. And just admit it. Be honest and say, yeah, that is my great fear. No question about it. Absolutely certain of that. I realized that when I was about 21 years old. I read that Ramana Maharshi one day lay down in his bedroom when he was a teenager and said, okay, I'm going to die. What's beyond death? And then went through and somehow his mind freed itself from all fear of death and impermanence. I said, I'm going to try that. So I lay down and I tried to let go of death and impermanence. And what I found out was I had this massive tsunami of terror and dread. It just was incredible. And I just said, what in the world is that? Where did that come from? I didn't used to have that. And I said, uh-oh, there's a continuity problem. I became aware of the continuity problem at that time. So I've been working on it ever since to see, you know, where did this come from? What's going on? How come I have this? You know, all these questions. Over many, many, many years, over decades, you know, three and a half decades of work on this. We do have a continuity problem, absolutely. We absolutely do. Severe, severe continuity problems. Very frightening thing. The fear of an abrupt awakening where all problems, all form, all perception vanishes in the instant forever. How many of us would embrace that and say, oh, that's great, sure, I'm ready for that. Who among us is actually ready for that? Anyway, you know, if they are, then go ahead and do it. Don't talk about it, do it. The rest of us, if we say we have no fear of that, we're liars. You know, we're not being honest. That is for sure. So you have to practice honesty. Say, yeah, I do have a continuity problem. And then you somehow the Holy Spirit lets you know that it's there and it's got it covered for you. Because it is there, and it does have it covered for us. And you gradually get clued into all this, get clued into it by various teachings, various teachers, various insights, various dreams, various clarifications, etc. The whole ball of wax, you gradually become more and more tuned into this. All those guys and gals in the 60s and 70s, whatever, all the all the hippies and the drug dealers and everything, you know, they had their spiel and everything about how great it was, etc. But they weren't clear about anything, really. And I listened to him. I said, wait a minute, you're not really addressing the continuity issue at all. You're not addressing what I experienced. There's this terrible fear of a sudden, permanent awakening and loss of all perception, all form, all problems, all, you know, instant. That's our problem, really. And it's not being addressed. Nobody's addressing it. They're just, you know, they're just saying, hey, man, tune in, turn on, tune in. Turn on, tune in. Tune in, turn on, drop out, whatever. You can say any way you want to. Turn on, tune in, drop out. What is that? Does that solve a continuity problem? Does getting high solve the continuity problem? Is that admitting, yeah, I've got a continuity problem, and that's the only problem I have, and is that all? Is all taken care of just because somebody lights up a joint or something? Is that the cure for it? Come on. So, you know, it's like, in this world, you live among those who are just, you know, fooling around, comatose, and just saying, well, I want to have a nice comatose, and I want to feel good, comfortable with my comatosity, you know, get a little high in my comatosity or something. That's not anything. And so I realized that's not anything, it's not anything, but there's all pressures on everybody. So you get pulled down by these pressures, but still in the back of your mind you're saying, nah, this is all bogus, this isn't anything. I need to get the real stuff, the real good stuff, the actual good stuff, which is actually clarifications. So don't be concerned if you got pulled down. Be concerned, but realize, you know, that's what happens in this world. Is, you know, when you dwell in the land of comatosity, you're going to end up a cotomaton yourself to a certain extent. But the difference is, like, for me, I knew I was in a coma. This is pretty interesting. You talk about lucid dreaming. Well, I was in a lucid coma, comatic state, a lucid coma. I had a lucid coma. I was a lucid comatositon. And I was aware I was in a coma. I said, whoa, I'm in a coma. This is terrible. Whereas most people are not aware they're in a coma. So that was a very interesting situation I've had. And so from within the coma, I worked to bring myself out of the coma, basically, is what happened. And I'm still working on it. It goes slowly. You don't get out of it immediately, generally speaking. It differs among different people to various extents for some reason. But there hasn't been a lot of success in this world when it comes to coming out of a coma. Not really. I think the ancients were more into it than we are. We have our dumb phones now. You know, why do we need to be into awakening from comatosity when we can deepen our coma by, you know, the earbuds and walking like this all day long, you know, just, you know, we can get into a really great coma thanks to Apple and, well, Steve Jobs and all those wonderful folks that are, you know, bringing you all this stuff, this technology, etc. You can go into a real deep coma now. Deepen your coma. Really, really deepen it. Not to pick on Apple or Steve Jobs or anything. It just happens that they're local folks, so I can tweak them a little bit. I think I, you know, grew up around them and the whole situation here. Nobody tweaks Apple much anymore because it's the most powerful corporation in the world. You know, it didn't used to be that way. It was a little runt here, and it was the Valley's darling, and then it fell apart. It had run on really rough times, and, you know, it was just really just almost defunct, you know, and then it surged back, and now is the behemoth, you know. But its stock and trade is to deepen your coma. That's its stock and trade, absolutely. Let's not shy away from speaking truth to authority at all. or speaking truth to truth to half truths. So, the ancients were way more into it than we are, let's face it. Just be honest about it. They really got after it. I mean, they'd spend, you know, renounce the world, spend a whole lifetime in a cave meditating, literally. I mean, they did, that's what they did. And, a lot of them awakened. A lot of them, there were a lot of awakening throughout history, ancient times for sure. These days, not so much. We got too much music to listen to. We got too much groovy, you know, too many groovy graphics to look at and movies to watch and styles to wear and, you know, makeovers to be had and too many places to go. And the world is our oyster, you know. Too many connections to make, too many tweets to make, too many emails to read, too many texts to send, and too much money to be made. Too many remodels to be done and redecorations to be done and cars to buy and careers and jobs and stocks to get and future to be won. Too much of all that, so we don't have time to awaken from our coma. The mantra of the world is enjoy your coma. That's it. Hey, enjoy your coma. Stick those earbuds in and play those video games and enjoy your coma. Celebrate your coma. And today, the Superbowl day is Celebrate Your Coma Day on planet Crudcoma. Worldwide, Celebrate Your Coma Day. Indulge your coma. Feel good about your coma. Feel good about it. Esteem your coma. Yeah, everybody's working on esteeming their coma. I got a great coma. This is wonderful. Very deep coma. Very solid. Very well defended. Not much fear of awakening with me. Or you got it made then, right? Yeah, well, everybody's got it made here. All got new cars, that's for sure, in this area. We should put after our name, instead of PhD, we should be C-O-M-A. John Smith, C-O-M-A. A degree in comatosity from planet Crudcoma. Cruel, raw, unlimited delusion. Hoorah, unlimited delusion, something like that. You can use whatever you want to. So, we all have that. All pinned down from the continuity of fear. Fear of sudden awakening, vanishing of all province forever. We're all posers, just admit it. We're all posers. Say, oh yeah, I want to awaken. I want enlightenment. That's nonsense. Everyone's saying, yeah, I want to be enlightened. I want to be self-realized. How do I get the empowerment, you know, of this, all this stuff. That's all posing. Everyone's posers, really. We're all posers. And we don't really want to lose all our problems instantaneously, forever. No way. No way. And if we're not aware of the continuity problem and how it's resolved, then we're just whistling Dixie. We're not going to get, you know, we're not going to get there, really. We're just going to maybe master some rhetoric or something. Yeah, but stay in our coma, stay in our cozy coma. Well, you know what? I can cut a third part to this, or edit it into this video. It's getting a little chilly out here, and it's actually getting quite late. So this is, I'm taping this actually the night before the Super Bowl. Maybe I can tape something tomorrow. Or maybe not, I don't know. Don't really try to pin myself down. What am I going to do at any particular moment? Because you never know when some insight, some clarification is going to happen and your whole life changes, really. I mean, your perspective changes and you say, whoa, I only have a continuity problem, that's it. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. And so your values change. Your values can change. Just like going in there, I can't bring myself to do all this graphic stuff. I got so many pictures on my computer, spiritual theme stuff, so much stuff. You know, it's beautiful, incredible stuff. I just can't put it together. I just can't seem to do it. It just doesn't happen. I tried with the Ramon Maharshi quotes thing, but after that it was just like, it just doesn't fly. It doesn't fly anymore. It doesn't have escape velocity. It can't get off the ground, really. It's better to focus on, I have a continuity problem. That is way more effective. And, you know, what is that? Continuity anonymous. Continuity problem anonymous. Hi, I'm Clarity Ross and I have a continuity problem. welcome. Yeah, we should have that. Continuity problem anonymous. CPA. I'm a member. I'm a CPA. So continuity problem anonymous member. And people just start admitting it. And then the whole thing shift. The whole value system of the world could shift when we realize that people accept they have a continuity problem. Absolutely, the values of the whole world, whole entire world could shift. They would shift because they'd look at this other stuff and say, there's no value there. No value there. So really, shifting of values is possible here. In fact, we have to shift values. I know a lot of activists have tried to shift values in a lot of different directions, like environmentalists and all this kind of stuff. And I'm aware of all that stuff, but I said, wait a minute, this is not actually what works, though. Only the vision of oneness has value. You know, to awaken from a dream, you have a continuity problem, and that has to be resolved. You have to admit you have a continuity problem before you can meet. Before you will see the remedy as having value. Otherwise, you won't see the remedy at all. You say there's no value there, therefore I'm not seeing anything. I'm not going to pay any attention to it. Because why pay attention to what has no value? You won't do it. You won't do it. So all this, you know, changing of values in the world, that's just trying to feel cozy in your comatosity. I don't have an activist problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an environmental problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a cause problem. I have a continuity problem. All these causes in the world. I don't have a cause problem. Don't have a cause problem. I have a continuity problem. Thank you very much. So you see, it's possible to have spiritual practice. I'm just trying to showcase this and show it is possible. You can, what I'm doing, you absolutely can do. This is not difficult. It's only difficult if you don't value it, and then it becomes impossible. But if you approach it in the right way and see value in it, then it's not difficult, actually. It requires some focus and willpower and effort, of course, but it's not technically difficult at all. Just say I have a continuity problem. How difficult is that for anybody to just admit, see, I have a continuity problem. That's it. And then say, it's the only problem that I have. Right? And then the others try to come up and say, oh, but I have that. No, I don't have that problem. I don't have a sleep problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a sleep problem. I have a continuity problem. Now, will you start sleeping perfectly well? No. Because you're still not, you know, sure. You know, you're transitioning. Your valuing is in transition. So you're not going to abruptly, it's not likely, you could. I mean, Christian Science, the whole theory behind Christian Science healing was basically to deny the problem. There is no such problem, you know. You're perfect, your health is absolutely perfect. You don't, you know, it's essentially the same basic principle at work in Christian Science is they really, continuity fear is what it really was. But you can, if specifically, they try to specifically heal certain illnesses and stuff like that, which was where they were at that time. But now we're at a place now where we have a much more streamlined, clear, direct teaching and understanding. So we can literally go for the whole ball of wax right now. So you can just say, I don't have a healing problem, I have a continuity problem. That covers everything. But they were certainly on the right track, for sure. Christian scientists. And healings happened all the time. They had tremendous success in healings. Tremendous success. That's something that's not ever talked about anymore, is it? But, you know, they had an amazing success in many, many instances. People were healed of all kinds of illnesses simply by having a session with a Christian scientist and allowing the certainty of a Christian scientist to take the lead in their belief system. And that the Christian scientist would just say, I know, you know, you don't have cancer. You don't have a cancer problem. You know, and they transfer it over. I don't know exactly, you know, I didn't try to do that, so I cannot speak exactly how they did it. I've read it and studied it. I know all about it, but I never tried to do that. I never tried to cure anything, really. So, but because we can get the whole ball of wax, why worry about curing this or that when you can cure the whole thing? The whole thing. That saves time, because saving time is where it's at. So Christian Science has dwindled away for a large part, but the momentum that it created in the world, eventually it went into new thought, you know, unity, universe, all these various new thought teachings, and then it enabled the Course in Miracles to have traction in the world. People kind of could relate to it, and to a certain extent, with various background in new thought and Christian Science and other teachings. Hey, cat, settle down. But it's kind of dwindled away, and now they're, you know, being persecuted. But now we're at this stage where we can let go of all problems in one decision, all problems that could ever arise. No need to try and heal them one by one. Because we just say, I have a continuity problem, that's the only problem I have. Period. That's it. And God has a resolution of that, so there's no problem whatsoever. The continuity problem is not going to be a problem for me. I mean, it ends up being the potentiality for problems without actually experiencing any problems. So we're in a better spot. We're in a better spot right now, no question about it. And those who awaken, or at least abiding in the vision of oneness, resonate in unconcern throughout the entire planet as in regard to problems. And that literally diminishes all problems for everybody. Diminishes them. It doesn't get rid of them, because people don't want that. They're still too frightened. But it does diminish them, and it moves everybody closer towards recognizing that they only have one problem, a continuity problem. It's a subtle thing, but it's true. Everybody gets helped. But the Superbowl doesn't help anybody. It helps everybody stay in a coma, but that's not help, is it? That's a little confusing to say that's help. That's like saying, I'm being helped to avoid help. Is that help? Yes, the ego would say, yeah, that's help, because you're avoiding, you're getting help, so it must be help. Yeah, but you're getting help for what? It's a half-truth. I'm getting help for what? The ego says, oh, you're getting help, and he said, well, that's the true part, and then the other part is getting help and avoiding help, and that's the false part. So we have a half-truth here. We can, you know, build a house on that foundation. No, you can't. No, you can't, because getting help and avoiding help is not help. It makes a mockery of reason and truth, and right? Completely. It's whimsicality. Whimsicality. How can we build a, you know, trying to build a new reality on a foundation of whimsicality? Not possible. My watch has stopped working because it's a light-powered watch. There's no battery. And it's covered up, so I have to open up to light. As soon as the light hits it, then it goes back on again. It's getting late. It's getting late in the world, as a matter of fact. The world's going to go into a collective exercise in comatosity. A comatosity exercise of, let's everybody see how, if we can get our coma even deeper. And as everybody's into it, say, wow, we're headed for a big success. Or just on the brink of a huge success, because we're going to deepen our coma to such an extent we may never have to even wake up. How about that, folks? That's where we're at. We're on the brink of that. We've been prepped for it. Everyone's been prepped for it. They're all ready for it. They got their earbuds in and their dumb phones, and they're all ready for it to receive their marching orders and how they can get into such an incredibly deep coma that they may never come out of it and won't even have to think about coming out of it. They'll forget all about coming out of it. Therefore, poof, the continuity problem vanishes. No more continuity problem. That's the great goal of the world that all these great thinkers have come up with. Well, the cats get definitely restless. He's not going to settle down. No way. Hungry stomach does not settle down easily, does it? That is for sure. So we definitely do have to realize that we don't have a coma problem, we have a continuity problem. I don't have a coma problem, I have a continuity problem. State it. Insist on it. I don't have any coma problem. I have a continuity problem. Choose your problem. You have the right to choose your problem, right? Absolutely you do. 100%. Because you've chosen all these problems in the first place. God didn't give us any of these problems. We chose to have all these problems. And we can choose to have just one problem, the continuity problem. It's our choice. We have free will. We can choose to have just the continuity problem. Maybe the cat is going to start interfering with the camera. If he can figure it out, he certainly would to get me to feed him. So they figured out the computer thing, right? They walk on the computer, the keyboard, you know, you're going to get upset and get up and feed him, right? Just walk across it. Not, haven't figured out this video thing yet. So I don't have a coma problem, I have a continuity problem. And again, how do you start out when you're working, driving, shopping, whatever, eating, distracted somehow? You say, well, I have a continuity problem. You start out with the first statement of honesty, I have a continuity problem. And then you say, the continuity problem is the only problem that I have. And then you can start to enumerate various things that come up as the problems that you think that you've had, or you've, you know, and then you say, and I don't have that. Deny it. Say, I don't have that problem. I have a continuity problem. Never deny a problem by itself. Don't say, oh, I don't have that problem. Leave it at that. That's bad. Hey. starting to cause a commotion here. Knocking stuff off the table. That's good. Hey. Remember that I don't have a cat problem. I have a continuity problem. But I also don't have a stupidity problem. Hey. There you go. You got the video camera. Nice. Smart cat. You see? He almost knocked the video camera over. Very good. Very smart cat. Figured it out. Figured that one out. How about that, you see? Cats are very smart, actually. Very, very clever creatures. And he rocked the video camera right there. Very good. Well, awesome. Don't have a cat problem. I have a continuity problem. But the cat thinks that he has a human problem. So I've not been able to cure the cat of that belief yet. So anyway, hopefully we've brought us through the Super Bowl here. Had a lot of fun, had a lot of insight, had a lot of clarification, had spent our time in the right way. And way better for it, having done so. And we say, what? I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem that I have. I don't have a Super Bowl problem. I have a continuity problem. See? Insist on it. Insist that you have a continuity problem. Own it. Own it. Absolutely own it. And you will be very pleased with the progress that you make. You won't be overwhelmed, but you'll be very, very pleased. This is what I have seen in this practicing this, okay? So, again, as you forget, what I forget, oh, I have a continuity problem, right? I have a continuity problem. That's it.